Brent and Daniel here. We're here for a special Codex review here of the new Traitor's Hate, right? Yes, Traitor's Hate that Daniel picked up. So, as you guys know, Daniel plays Chaos. So he's a glutton for punishment in that way, right? And Daniel has decided to give this one a shot. And I'm going to go ahead and preface this. We both think it's actually pretty good. We both think it has a lot of very positive formations, and some, in my honest opinion, and I don't know, do you agree at all?
I think a lot of this was a much-needed pick-me-up for Chaos.
Yeah, I agree. I just kind of feel, specifically, there's one formation that I feel, and I think Daniel sort of agrees based on his mischievous grin, that it's a little bit broken, like, up there in terms of one of the most powerful formations in the game, and... Yeah, it could be very, very broken. But we're coming to that. We're going to start off here with some of the basically existing modifiers for rules here. So this isn't... it's going to be very brief. So we have Chaos Vindicators. Nothing's changed on them per se. However, they now have a special rule that if you have a unit containing three, they can all choose to fire on the same target. And instead of it being a large blast, it becomes that massive apocalyptic blast that's... When you absolutely positively have to kill every freaking thing on the map, right?
Yeah.
Okay, so...
No more horde.
Yeah. No, there's no more much of anything at that point. But yeah, that's a new rule. So that's actually pretty crazy. Now, obviously, it requires 360 points spent to Vindicators, but...
Yeah.
It's still pretty good. Let's see here.
Predator,
yeah, so Predators have a similar rule, but not Blast. It's, you can take three of them in a unit, and when you do, they all get Monster Hunter Tank Hunter. So, it's a good, it sort of makes a valid reason to bring a Predator, I think. I kind of think before, Chaos Predators weren't really, you know, a thing, because they didn't really seem to have a purpose. Giving them Monster Hunter Tank Hunter, especially if you give them, like, the last cannon. And the, like, you know, spawns and last cannons.
Well, I think they come standard with the last cannon.
Do they?
It says they don't. No, auto cannon, you're right.
Yeah. They say right here, they changed to it. Yeah, no. They still have the auto cannon standard. 25 points for that link, twin linked, and then you can take spawns and mounted last cannons for two more. So, three last cannons with Tank Hunter or Monster Hunter is... pretty good.
Yeah.
Granted, that does mean you have to take three and in a squad, but it's not a bad special rule, to be fair, right? I mean, it's...
If you've got the Predators for it, like...
It's worth it?
I'd say so. All right. No reason not to.
Alright, so if you got the Predators, you're going to field it. There you go. See, then there's the new Karn model for Karn the Betrayer. Nothing's really changed for him per se, although he now has, I don't know if he had this previously or not, I don't think so, but now his, or it might have been written into another rule, but all his melee attacks now always hit on twos, even if they would hit automatically, so, i.e. you're hitting a, you know, a vehicle or a building or something that can't move, then you hit on twos still, and then he has all the usual stuff on a one, he automatically hits a friend, because... Roar!
Yeah. Blood for the blood god.
There you go. Something has to die for Karn, right?
Yep. Still 160 points, though, so...
Yeah. No real modifier to any of his Gore Child, or... Still has Nexus of Corn, Betrayer, and Blessing of the Blood God. So, all those special rules, same stuff.
Yeah.
So next, you know, like, we have...
Corn Lord of Skulls. Hadn't seen this model until this codex, so...
Yeah, I think he's existed, but I don't think he's really been easy to obtain for, like, non-Corn legions. I think you can actually now bring him as part of, like, normal Chaos Space Marines due to... This is just part of the, you know, Space Marine Codex. So, he is expensive, though. 888 points, so, yeah, he's expensive. Comes with all the normal stuff, I think, that he previously had. Gore Storm, Hades Gatling Cannon, Great Cleaver, Demonic Possession, Demon Forge, Fleet, it will not... Fleet, wow, okay. Fleet, it will not die. And isn't he a super heavy?
Yeah, super heavy walker.
Well, why would he even have Fleet? Like, he can't run. Super heavies can't run, right? Like, that's kind of... I guess for charge distance. All right. Okay, so Fleet for charge. It will not die, Rage, Demon of Corn, Fueled by Rage, Tracked Behemoth. And then he can take an Ichor Cannon, a Demon Gore Cannon instead of his Gore Storm. And then he can take a Hades Gatling Cannon instead of Skull Hurler. So I'm pretty sure all those weapon profiles are already out there, so we're not really going to go into depth on those. But I think it's... I don't really think anything's changed with him. I just think now he's available for everyone instead of, like, specifically Khorne stuff. So, hey, it's a Lord of War. If you got him, I guess you can throw it on the field.
There's a formation now.
Yeah, there's a formation if you have... If you have 2,600 plus points that you really got to burn, there's a formation for three. But yeah, we're going to that one later.
Yeah.
All right, so we're going to start off with the formations now. We have the basic formation here, which is sort of a better version of a CAD, I guess.
Taking a lot of the same things.
Yeah. So we have formation requires a Chaos Lord. Now there's a notation that says you can take Abaddon, Huron, Karn, Typhus, or Lucius, or Fabius instead of a lord. And then you can take 0/1 sorcerer, and you can choose to take Ahriman instead of a sorcerer if you, again, have points to burn, I guess. Because, you know.
Yeah, it's Ahriman, or, you know.
Well, it's just that Chaos are so points efficient that, you know, you gotta burn those points somehow. Can't even say that one right. Yeah, it's... If you really, really want Ahriman. So, there you go. And then Chaos Lord you can replace with just about anything. And, of course, they would give the usual, you know, benefits. Typhus lets you take Plague as troops. And, you know, if you took Karn, Berserkers.
I'm not actually sure how some of those rules are going to play into this formation.
Well, that's true, because this formation doesn't have troops anymore. It's more of a detachment thing. So... Going into that, you take 0/1 sorcerers, 1-3 units of chosen, chaos terms, or possessed, 2-6 units of chaos space marines, so they're going to make you bring some of those. Yeah, because they're not very points efficient there, but hey, you know, there's still 3 up armor. It's not like chaos space marines are bad, it's just, it'd be nice if they were slightly cheaper, basically. Like, even if you only took 5 points off a squad, honestly, you probably need 10 points, but even if you only took 5 points off, I think they'd be more viable, but they're okay. It's not like they're bad, it's just generally you're kind of wishing you had something else, like you'd rather take Plague or Berserkers or...
Well, I suppose we can get into this, but with this formation, when you, like, it's one of the 3 core formations for the new detachment.
Yeah, we're coming to the detachment later, but yeah.
Yeah,
there's a reason to bring it, basically.
Yeah.
So you also get 1-3 from Raptors, Warp Talons, or Bikers. And then you get 1-3 of Havocs or Hellbrutes. I find that one kind of an odd, like, combination, Havocs versus Hellbrute.
Yeah.
Like, they don't really even necessarily have the same purpose. It's kind of, you know, Raptors, Warp Talons, and Bikers make sense, because they're all, you know, assault-oriented things here. And they're all, you know, have movement benefits and things to that nature that get them in quicker. And even the Chosen and Terminators and Possessed, I can sort of see, just because they're kind of like vanity, like, you know, tweaks to the stuff. They do different things, but, like, to me, that's where you're going to modify what you're going to do with this army.
I mean, as I see it, like, the Chosen, Terminators, Possessed, those are all elite choices.
Yeah.
Warp, Talons, Raptors, those are all fast attack. And, like, I think this was their attempt at, like, maybe a heavy support section.
Yeah, possibly. But it's just, I don't know, it feels awkward to be, like, 1-3 Havocs or Hellbrutes, because, especially in light of, like, the rest of the choices, it's just, it's kind of,
okay.
What? Yeah, it's like, okay, I mean, you can take 1-3, so it's not like you have to choose, but, I don't know. It's just, It's an odd like combination. I think the Havocs would have made more sense like putting them with the like chosen determines or possessed. Like I think that would have made more sense. And then putting like Hellbrute / Forge Fiend and doing like a vehicle section. But
it is interesting there's no like demon engines.
Yes. There's no other vehicles in this formation. Like what we've just listed, that's the end of formation. So you can't take the Predators, Vindicators, Forge Fiends, anything else. It's Hellbrutes if you want vehicles with this formation. So basically it's sort of a glorified CAD. You get that usual objective secured, and then other special role is Favored Scion. So Daniel probably knows more a bit about how this one works, so I'll let him explain this one.
It seems to be essentially like a bonus role on your chaos table, and it allows you the option of
the boon, right?
Yeah, either taking that extra is that right? Yeah, you can either take one or both of the results then, so if
you... Yeah, so you roll twice, basically.
Just happen to roll to be the unspeakable chaos nonsense, you don't have to be it.
Yeah, you don't have to do spawn, basically. On the plus side, though, if you roll two good ones, you can take both, so...
It's very true.
Yeah, it's an interesting special rule. Certainly, it's not a bad one to have. And based on the other units in this list... You should probably be able to take advantage of it because you're going to have, you know, especially with the Raptor, Warp Talon, Biker like choices, you're going to have someone in there fighting. Also, interesting of note, there are no cultists in this list.
Which is where, like, Typhus comes in. Like, you're not taking those plague zombies now.
Yeah, well, yeah. I would say overall it's an okay formation just because of the favored scions, but if you're going to bring it. I think you're generally going to bring this as part of a detachment because of the detachment special rule.
Yeah.
Which, we're going to go with formations first, then we'll come back to detachments because it'll make more sense whenever we're saying, you can bring this formation for the detachment. And, yeah. More or less, the warband is going to have more of a place as part of the detachment, I think, than on its own.
Yeah.
That said, I mean, it's not like it's a bad formation. Direction secured isn't bad, and if you're going to bring a CAD and you're basically going to bring, you know, a list similar to this in the first place, then you may as well bring this because you get a benefit on top of the CAD.
Yep.
So next we have one of the more powerful formations, and this is powerful, don't get me wrong, but this isn't the one that we think will be borderline, you know, game-breaking in terms of what you can do. But it's still a really powerful formation, and we definitely think it'll get some play.
In my mind, at least, this is a formation you could run on its own. Like, you don't have to take this as the part of the detachment, necessarily.
Yeah, you can just like be like, I'm going to bring this plus a CAD or something.
Yeah.
I think that's very reasonable based on the setup here, because I don't necessarily know if this would work as an army on its own. But in any case, the formation is called Maelstrom of Gore here. So the formation is one Chaos Lord or Karn, and 4 to 8 units of Berserkers. So that is a lot of Berserkers.
Yeah.
Restrictions, the Chaos Lord must be given Mark of Khorne, but you get it for free, so you don't have to pay for it. So if you don't take Karn, and you take a Chaos Lord for 65 points, you get Mark of Chaos, which is normally, what, like 20 points?
I'd have to check, but yeah, it's somewhere between 10 and 20.
Yeah, it's not a cheap upgrade, so it's a free upgrade, and... You know, never sneeze at free stuff, right?
In a codex where you have to pay for everything.
Yeah, exactly. And let's be honest, the Chaos can probably use all the discounts they can get. So
yeah.
I think this is actually a good attempt by Games Workshop to try to shoehorn in some cheaper stuff in the form of discounts. And that's going to actually, I think, be a running theme with a lot of this. They're trying to give discounts for a lot of equipment and upgrades that you normally wouldn't get. And even units. And that's going to be a big theme in Traitor's Hate, is getting discounts on stuff. So, what do you get for bringing 4 to 8 units of Berserkers and a Chaos Lord with Mark of Karn, or Khorne, or Karn? Well, you get Blood Crazed, which is Maelstrom of Gore units have Fleet, which is really good. Oh, yeah. Getting Fleet on an Assault unit is phenomenal. I can tell you from Harlequins, my Dark Elder Incubi, like, without Fleet, I would fail a lot of stuff. So, that is a big deal. And especially since Space Marines don't ever have that.
Well, and then on top of that...
Yeah. Then on top of that, you get to add 3 inches to your charge range. So that means you could possibly charge 15 inches. But it also means the average charge range goes up to 10 inches instead of 7. Which makes that... With fleet, makes that... You have a reasonable charge distance of about 12 inches, probably.
Yeah.
Which is insane.
Oh, yeah.
You could put these guys in a... you know, put them in a land... Take one squad, throw them in a Land Raider, move the Land Raider 6, you know, deploy 6 inches away, and you're only 12 inches away from your opponent at that stage. So what you're looking for is a 9-inch charge at that stage, because you get plus 3 and with fleet.
A little above average, but yeah.
Yeah, it's above average, but with fleet, you have a decent chance at it. You know, if you roll a 6 or a 5, you don't have to re-roll that one. You just re-roll the lower dice and hope you get lucky. But... It's actually a reasonable thing that you could possibly do.
Yeah.
But beyond that, 3 inches plus fleet makes them a very powerful assault force, for sure. It's reasonable to foot slog them if you really want to, or you can shove them in, you know, some rhinos and just not expect to get that turn one charge and just move up 6, deploy them. Like, just do this turn one, because you want to assault turn two, is you just put them in rhinos, move up 6, deploy them 6, and then run with fleet. So if you roll a 1, you just re-roll it. You know, or even a 2, you probably re-roll it. But yeah. So you're going to get a lot closer than, you know, normally you would. So it's a, it's definitely a very scary formation, and it is very powerful. And I think it's something, like, it's something that's really going to be a big deal for the Berserkers, for sure.
Well, getting to the next special rule, like, this is probably my favorite part of the formation.
Yeah.
It's Red Rain. And so once per game at the start of your movement phase, you essentially get to attack a unit if you're in close combat with it already.
Well, not just a unit. Every single... all units in the formation. So if multiple units in this formation are in close combat... You basically get an extra turn to attack them, and they do not get to fight back.
Yeah.
That specifically says, only you get to attack.
And that's so brutal.
Yeah. But it's in the movement phase, so it's... You've got to essentially go through a round of combat first. So, and it has to make it... Well, 2 rounds, because it's got to make it back to you. Or if someone's... I don't know why you would do this, but if you were to charge Khorne Berserkers... on your turn, then on his turn, you know, he could say, I'm using Red Rain, and he gets a free attack on you before you can fight back.
Yeah.
So. It's definitely a very cool, you know, very thematic, I think, even. Yeah. Like, it's definitely a very fluffy ability for them, and I think that's a... It's a really cool thing. You know, I think that's a really cool decision by Games Workshop to do that. That was... I think it's a good formation, it's healthy for the game, and I think it's a fun formation. And it definitely helps. Yeah, you just got to get there. But with, you know, an average charge range of 10 inches now, you should be able to get them there. 10 inches is a big-ass charge range.
Well, and a minimum of 4 units now, like, hopefully someone makes it.
with 4, yeah, you would hope someone makes it there. But that does, of course, mean it's expensive. Like, a Khorne Berserker squad is what, like, 80?
Good question. 105.
So yeah, there you go. That is the downside to the formation. 420 points minimum plus the Chaos Lord. So 400. What is it? 420. So
420. Yeah. That's not including, you know, taking any chain axes. Or...
Yeah. So 485 is the minimum cost for this formation. So you can fit it into a 750 point game even if you really, you know, tried to shoehorn it in there. But you could do it. And this in a 750 point game would be very scary. So, I mean, yeah, I think it's not awful. Well, not just not awful. I think it's actually a really cool formation, and even the downside being the price of it isn't 400 points, especially if you're paying, you know, in a 1500 point game. That's really not a big deal.
No,
you can find the points to do that, and you will hopefully be rewarded with some very cool moments, because I think this is a really cool formation. I know it's one you're looking forward to putting on the table.
Yes, definitely.
All right, so we're going to move on to this other one. I think this one's going to be sort of one of those low-flying under-the-radar formations, but I think it'll be a really... I think this will be one of those formations that you can surprise your opponent with and get some surprising mileage out of, because it's very cheap. Formation called the Lost and the Damned. The formation is one Dark Apostle, which is 105 minimum, right?
105, yeah.
Yeah. And then 4 to 9 units of cultists. So, yeah, those are 50 points apiece. So, minimum point for this is 305 points to build this. So, it's a pretty cheap formation. And that's, again, with no upgrades, but, you know, if you, even if you gave all the cultists auto guns... you know, and not cannot assume you added cultists, but if you give them all auto guns, it's roughly 60 points apiece, so that's 240 plus 305. Okay. So
still not breaking 400.
Yeah, you're still not going to break 400, so that's still very reasonable. So what do you get? Why would you possibly want to throw four, you know, cultist squads on the field in a formation? Well, you get Tide of Traitors, which is pretty crazy. Every time a cultist squad is destroyed, roll a dice. On a 4, you immediately get to place a new identical squad into ongoing reserve. The squad also gains outflank. So, outflank, you can come on and charge the same turn because it's not a deep strike. It's... yeah. Yeah.
I hope you like cultists.
Yeah, yeah. But, I mean, it is on a 4, so it's not a guarantee. But, you know, if you feel a 4... For the price of 4 cultist squads, you're basically going to average getting 6, on average. Obviously, you know, statistics are statistics and don't always happen. You could very possibly have all 4 of them not come back, especially if you're Daniel. But it's you can rely at least on getting probably at least 1 and... if you get lucky, even all 4. I mean, just as you're as likely to get all 4 as you are to get none of them. So, you know, it's extra value, which again, as we've said, seems to be a theme in this codex here. It's adding extra value to your units. So, yeah, it's a really cool special rule. If you give them auto cannons or auto guns, essentially they just become respawnable guard.
Yep.
And if you give them melee, they just become respawnable tar traps. So
I could see this being really useful to, like, you know, surprise attack some of the, like, backfield objectives.
Yeah, because yeah, an outflank, you can, you know, you can appear as far down that opponent's side as you want. So
especially with how we play, we usually keep two objectives on either side.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we usually try to space them out. So yeah, I think this will be one of those cool under the radar flying formations that I actually think will get some, you can actually get some reasonable use out of. Okay. Not to say like cultists are amazing, but I mean, even Imperial Guard players have to field Imperial Guard, right?
Yeah.
So, I mean, it's essentially what you're doing here is just putting guardsmen on the field if you pay for the auto cannons or auto guns. So, yeah. The other special rule is Prophet of the Gods. The Dark Apostle Zealot applies to all Lost in the Damned, so all the cultists, within 6 inches of him. So it's a very small bubble. I kind of feel like they could have stretched that to 12 inches, but...
I mean, just looking, so like the other special rules, like the Dark Apostle comes with to begin with, gets a... how do you think it's called? Demagogue?
Demagogue.
Demagogue. Yeah, but that's also 6 inches, and that's at, like, those units get to use his leadership.
Again, but, like, cultists are so blobby, like, you trying to keep more than 2 units, even. Like,
you pick a favorite.
Yeah, so basically, at best, you're going to get 2 units in your little bubble. You can get 3 if you really try to work, but then you're just begging for blast templates at that point. So,
yeah, I
don't know. I kind of think they could have made it 9 inches, even, and that would have been that would have been enough to... you know, give you possibly keeping 3 of them, especially when you have to bring 4 squads. So also of note, the Dark Apostle does not benefit from that, you know, he can reappear rule. So once he dies, he dies. But that doesn't affect the special rule. The cultists can continue to respawn, and it even says if one of the respawn units dies, you still roll that dice, and so basically a repeat ad nauseum there. So
they continue to count as part of the formation.
Yes, exactly. They're always part of the formation, which means when they die, you always reroll. And on four, they come back again. So it's possible they just never, ever die. Now, it does also say, though, that they do count for kill points for your opponent. So if you are playing a kill point game, this probably isn't the formation you want, but let's be honest, if you're playing a kill point game, you're not bringing cultists, so.
Well, hopefully not.
Yeah, you don't want to be bringing cultists if you're playing kill points, because, yeah, they're just free kills.
Hellforge?
Oh, yeah. So, Hellforged War Pack. This is kind of one that, I don't know, I think we were looking at, we were like, it's okay?
Yeah.
But
it's nothing special. No, it's not bad.
No, it's not bad. It's just, it's very overshadowed by a lot of the other options you have in this. And it's like, if you're going to bring the units in this, anyways, then you might as well. But
yeah,
it's not a, like, oh, wow, you should totally try to, you know, bring this formation, such as, like, you know, Maelstrom of Gore over here, or even the Lost and the Damned. It's a formation you look at and say, I might try to bring that formation. You're not going to go out of your way to bring this. You're going to be like, I'm already bringing the units, I guess, or just call them, you know, this.
Yeah, like, I wouldn't go out to buy, like, two more Forge Fiends or, you know, a Defiler just to have for this.
Yeah, so the formation is one Warp Smith, which is 110.
110, yeah.
A Hellbrute, a Mauler Fiend, a Forge Fiend, or a Defiler, and you can choose between those, and you have to have a minimum of 3 up to 5. What do you get for that? Well, so basically, as long as the Warp Smith is alive, all models can use Demon Forge twice, essentially. Normally, I think that's you can only use it once per game, I think. Is that right?
It would make sense. Yeah, for one shooting or assault phase per game.
Yeah, so basically, as long as the Warp Smith's alive, you can use twice, essentially. Huh. Oh, wait. No, and or subsequent time. So you can use this as many times. So you can use, you can use your Demon Forge special rule as many times as you want, as long as the Warp Smith is alive, because it specifically says, during the game, can choose to do so for a second and or subsequent time.
At least how I interpret that is second, like you do it turn 2 and then turn 3, or like you do it twice in the same turn. Like, because you have two weapons.
I don't know, that's not how it reads to me. It reads to me like you still get to do it once per turn, because it still says, you know, it still seems to apply the normal rules. It's just, you get to keep using it. So basically, you can use it every turn if you want to, I think. It is a little bit murky. My interpretation, Daniel's interpretation. I don't have an answer for which one is correct, just because it's kind of the nature of
how these things work.
Yeah. The rule probably needs a bit of an FAQ on that one. If we interpret it my way, then it's not a bad buff. Essentially, you can reroll to hit every turn. It's not too bad.
I'll reroll all failed to wounds and armor penetration rolls. Like,
that's pretty reasonable.
Getting to do that every turn, though, seems...
Yeah, that's pretty powerful. If you interpret it in Daniel's, though, I don't know. It seems like, essentially, it's... If you can just keep doing it over and over, it just basically is like, I'm going to wound you with these attacks, no matter what. And I kind of feel that wouldn't make too much sense, but maybe. Either way, it's still a really powerful thing. Essentially, it's basically Demon Forge gives you shred, essentially, against anything, not just infantry. Other special rule is you can nominate one model from the Hellforge Warp Pack. One vehicle model, so not the Warp Smith. That model becomes the Alpha, so they then gain a 4 up invuln save, and then if that model dies, so it has to be vehicle model, if that model dies, all other models gain rage. So, you know, rage is a decent rule. But, again, you know, the drawing factor for this is going to be the Master of Mechanical Warpcraft, which is the, you know, Demon Forge thing. But, again, it's a good formation, but I don't think it's a formation you're going to go out of your way to field. It's just, you know, like, I kind of want to bring, you know, a couple Forge Fiends and a Hellbrew. You might be like, all right, I'll bring the Warp Smith too and just make it a formation. So, like I said, it's I at least that's my thought, is as someone who doesn't play Chaos, it's something that you're going to bring if you're going to bring those models anyways.
Yeah,
so.
And having a Warp Smith with vehicles is never a bad idea.
That's true, because he can repair, right? Yeah. He's like a tech marine, sort of.
Yeah, he's essentially a tech marine.
Yeah, so... Yeah, I mean, Hellforge Warpack, or Warpack, it is what it is. It's decent enough. It's not, you know, it's not as good as, say, like, you know, Maelstrom of Gore, and I would say it's probably around the same lines of Lost in the Damned.
Well, this is also the first auxiliary formation for the Detachment.
For the Detachment, so yeah, that'll probably come into play later when we talk about Detachments. So it doesn't really compete for the same slots, basically.
Yeah.
So we have a Helldrake Terror Pack here. It has a very interesting special rule we'll come to in a sec, but enemies within 12 inches of two...
Helldrakes.
Oh, yeah, sorry. Formation is 2-4 Helldrakes. Enemies within 12 inches of 2 get a minus 1 to the leadership. Enemies within 12 inches of 3 get minus 2. And then minus 3 if you're within 4, essentially. So basically, yeah, you just take...
Helldrakes minus 1.
Yeah, Helldrakes minus 1, and that's the leadership that you give in penalty. So it's not too bad. There's, you know, some shenanigans you can probably do with that. And definitely force some failed leadership checks more often. And there's reasons you might want to do that. You have Merciless Pursuit. When performing a Vector Strike with a model from the Helldrake Terror Pack, so in other words, with the Helldrake, against a unit that is pinned, falling back, or has gone to ground, the target suffers D6, Strength 7, AP 2 hits instead of only 1.
That's mean.
It's basically like, oh, you failed your morale check. Well, you're dead. That's pretty much what that's doing right there. It's like, oh, failed your morale check, now you die.
Yeah.
So, like I said, that can cause some... Between Rising Terror... making it more easy to force your opponent to fall back or get pinned. And you will never voluntarily go to ground if your opponent has this formation, because...
If you're smart.
Yeah, if you're smart. Because if you do, like, the unit's dead. It doesn't say it ignores cover, though. So, you at least still get your goes-to-ground cover for whatever good that does you.
Yeah.
I guess if it's, like, a two-up cover save, it's probably not as big a deal. But
well, you're not getting your armor...
Yeah, no, you're not getting your armor, that's for sure. But yeah, between the Rising Terror special rule making it easier to make enemies fall back, so you could potentially, you know, shoot a squad there and get them to fall back because you're within 12 inches of, you know, 2-3 Helldrakes, and then the Helldrakes can finish off with that Vector Strike and then just literally annihilate the squad. So it's actually a really cool formation. Expensive, because 2-4 Helldrakes.
Yeah.
But it's a very interesting, you know, thought process behind it. You try to make them run away, and then the Helldrakes finish them off. So, it's a pretty cool formation.
Definitely.
Again, though, I think it's going to be one of those... Do you have the points to really devote to 2-4 flyers, or not?
Like, do you have 2-4 flyers?
Do you have 2-4 flyers? But, you know, assuming you do, then... And you have the points to devote to it, which probably is not a smaller point game. It's going to be like over, you know, probably 1,500 points plus. It's probably when you're actually going to be able to field this, because I think Helldrakes are like 120.
Oof, I was just checking that. Helldrake, 170 actually.
Ooh, okay. So yeah, that's expensive. 170. Not that Helldrakes are bad. They're definitely powerful, but yeah. So it's expensive to bring this, but if you have the points, then, you know, might be worth a look-see. So we have Cult of Destruction, which is possibly one of the more...
It's on the edge of either being worth it or...
No, it's on the edge of being bad or being okay. It's probably one of the weaker formations. That said, it's a discount formation. So the formation is 1 to 3 warp spiths. Why would you bring more than one? I don't know.
Or why would you bring them with either?
Yeah. And then you can choose between obliterator, 3 to 5 units of obliterators or mutilators. Why would you bring mutilators? I guess I don't know.
Yeah.
I mean, I guess if they get attacked twice, it's not the worst, but they're still
just
bad.
Just stick with, like, the gore, Maelstrom of Gore, then.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. If you want a melee, you're going to go Maelstrom of Gore, or the one we're coming to soon, which is the broken one. So, more than likely, it's going to be Obliterators plus one Warp Smith, and so it's a discount formation, essentially, if you're intending to bring a lot of Obliterators in the first place. So, the way it works out is if you had a make a squad of 2 obliterators, 1 obliterator, and 1 obliterator for your other squads, and then a warp smith, you get a 30-point discount, essentially, assuming as long as you manage to keep 2 obliterators alive in a squad. Because your warp smith, special rule, it lets the unit attack twice. That's the special rule here. It lets within 8 inches of a... Yeah, so the Warpsmith has to stay 8 inches within, you know, within 8 inches of the squad. And as long as they are, the models in question attack twice. So the cool thing for obliterators, though, that means they get to fire the same weapon twice, because you only pick a weapon per round. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Obliterators fire one weapon per round. Units. So that means you can actually fire multiple last cannon shots, or, you know, auto cannon shots, or whatever. This formation also has some potential to be extremely broken with one of the new psychic spells, but we're going to that later. So by getting to fire twice, it's like getting 2 extra blood raiders, right? So if you're bringing a 2-1-1, you're basically paying for 4 blood raiders and you're getting the firepower of 6. So as long as you keep, you know, that 2-man squad alive. If the 2-man squad takes a casualty, then, you know, you basically, it's like losing 2 obliterators instead of 1, which hurts. But as long as that squad's alive and firing, you're getting a 30-point discount on, you know, your 6th obliterator from 5 to 6. So 30 points, not the biggest deal, but if you're going to bring, you know, 6 obliterators or even 7 anyways, then you may as well, because it is a discount. And yes, you have fewer models, but you're getting the same amount of firepower, which is probably the reason you're bringing them anyways, not for model count, because there's better ways to get model count.
Oh, yeah. Cultists.
Yeah, cultists, or even Marines, for that matter. Yeah. But, yeah, just anything, like, other than a 70-point model.
Yeah.
You're not paying for model count when you're buying obliterators. You're paying for the firepower.
Oh, yeah.
So, yeah, that's the downside. And then, now this substantially goes up if you say... when you get to... At 7 models, your firepower is still going to be that... you're still only going to get your... Oh, wait, no. 7 models is 3-1-1, right? So it's 5. Yeah, so if you're going to bring 7 obliterators, then what you could do instead is, like... I don't know why you necessarily... Well, I do, but... The logic would be you could bring 2 2-man squads, so then if 1 2-man squad dies, then you can double up on the other one.
A little flash thing. Sorry.
2 2-man squads die. If you have one of your 2-man squads die, your forge warp smith can then, you know, work on the other guy. And then if you're going to bring 8 obliterators, you could potentially bring a 3-1-1, and at that point, you're getting a 100-point discount, actually. So, again, as long as you don't lose a guy from that squad, you're getting a 100-point discount. In anything over 8 obliterators, you won't be getting a discount anymore. Now, like I said, you subtract 2 from the number I'm saying based on model count, because, or 3 in that case, but So if you have a 3-1-1, you're bringing 5 models, but you're getting the firepower of 8, roughly. Which equates to, if you brought 8, it would be 100 points more. Even with that Warp Smith added in, it's 100 points more. So we spent a while debating this one and talking about, like, why would you even use this? And we started doing some math. And basically, if you're going to bring a lot of obliterators, it's cheaper to bring 5 if you're going to bring 8 plus and get take your 100 point discount in terms of firepower and move on.
Yeah.
So basically, if you want to bring a lot of obliterators, this is a good formation for you. If not, then you should probably just move along, because it requires you to want to bring a lot of firepower from a blitz for it to be worthwhile. All right, there you go, battery charged. So we're on next formation here called Fist of the Gods. This is basically your vehicle formation. I think this one's going to be similar. I think Daniel agrees with me to the
Vindicator Predators.
Or the Hellforged War Pack. Like, if you're going to bring the models, then you will. But yeah. This is essentially Warp Smith, and then 3 to 5 chosen between Predators, Vindicators, and Land Raiders. So basically all your non-demon vehicles.
Well, I think you can give them demon possession to munch on the crew.
Yeah, but yeah, specific. It's all your non, like, you know, normal demon vehicle things.
Yeah.
So the special rules for it is any of these vehicles within 12 inches of the Warp Smith get 6 up invuln. Not amazing, but you know, if you're not going to get a save, at least you have a chance to avoid it. So 16.6 whatever chance is better than nothing. Other bonus, and this is probably the more relevant one, the Warp Smith from the formation gets a +1 bonus when attempting to repair a vehicle in this formation. So, again, nothing super to write home about here with the benefits from the formation, but if you're going to bring a Vindicator, a Predator, and a Land Raider, or, you know, some combination thereof anyways, then you may as well add a Warp Smith and bring him like that, because...
But do you think this would mesh well with, like, the formations, the new rules for Predator that are indicated at the beginning? Take 3 Predators?
Well, no, because it says units.
Ah.
So, if you brought a 3-tank unit of Predators, that's still just 1 unit of Predators.
All right.
So... while yes, you could absolutely do that, you still only have 1 Warp Smith. So the more vehicles you put out there, the harder it is, I think, for him to really maintain the, you know, repair work and stuff, and especially the 12-inch 6-up invuln bubble. Obviously, you know, if you're gonna bring a Land Raider and, like, both of those, you know, 3 Predators and 3 Vindicators, then yeah, you'd almost certainly take this because it helps out the formation. But
oh, yeah.
Yeah, those are units. You can't just bring 3 separate Predators and then take advantage of it, because it has to be, it specifies a unit of Predators or Vindicators.
All right. Warp Smith shows up in a lot of these formations.
Yeah.
I don't know how I feel about that.
Yeah, they definitely seem to be pushing the Warp Smiths.
It's a cool looking model.
I don't really understand why the Warp Smiths in the Cult of Destruction. Like, that just doesn't make sense to me, but whatever. I guess the idea is they're trying to get you to put them with the mutilators and then charge, because the mutilators would get an extra attack, which isn't awful, but...
Why do you have mutilators?
Yeah, kind of. So, this brings us to pretty much, I think we both agree, the most powerful formation, and I think we sort of agree that it's borderline overpowering formation. Like, it's...
On paper.
Let's just... On paper, yes. If the Chaos Codex was any better, I would say, like, this would probably be, in my opinion, one of the most powerful... like, the most powerful formation. Like, you know, on the level of Tau Optimized Stealth Cadre, where ignores cover, always hits rear armor. Like, it's on the level of that type of power. But because the Chaos Codex is lacking... it doesn't quite reach that level of power, but it's still... it basically is, like, you get to ignore the game rules with this. And any time a formation lets you just flat out ignore game rules, such as the tile optimized stealth cadre as an example. Like, yeah, that is the, you know, that's the setup for a game breakingly powerful formation. And that is what this is. So this is called Raptor Talon. The formation is one Chaos Lord and 3 to 5 units chosen between Raptors and Warp Talons. So the restriction, I don't know why this is a restriction, but the Chaos Lord gets a jump back for free. Why this is restriction and not just special rules, it's a benefit, if anything, because it's a 15-point upgrade normally, right?
Yeah, is that what we decided?
I think that's what it was. 15-point upgrade, I think, and you get it for free. Why that's a restriction, I don't know, but it is. So he, by default, gets a jump back.
Yeah, 15.
Okay, so yeah, saves you 15 points. Not too bad. Assuming you want your, you know, you're going to put him in this anyways. But 15. Well, you have to field him with this, so it does save you 15.
It's like a Aura of Dark Glory right there.
Yeah, so you can use that for something better. Give him an invul save, give him power weapon, give him, you know, whatever you want, you can actually pay for it with that savings. So the special rules, Predatory Warriors. This is the big one here. Units from this formation can charge the same turn they arrive from Deep Strike.
Just say that again, let it sink in.
Yeah. Units from the formation can charge when they arrive from Deep Strike. That's crazy. That really is insane. Yeah, there's a reason you can't normally charge from Deep Strike, because it's a little bit silly to have a unit just appear next to you and charge you whenever, you know, a lot of units in the game are very shooting-based and cannot fight in melee. Like, Tau, just off the top of my head. Like, Daniel will probably never, ever field this against Ollie, because basically, you will beat Tau with this formation, in my honest opinion. Like, if you bring this formation, you will beat Tau, because it completely counters what they do. And it's extremely punishing against any army that is very shooting-based. You know, against an army that's a little bit tougher, such as other Marines, or, you know, an assault-based army like Harlequins, God help you charging into Harlequins, but, you know, you wouldn't field this formation against them anyways. I mean, at least not assault-based army. Like, you wouldn't field this against Orcs, probably. But you might field it, though, against, like, Dark Eldar or even Space Marines. It's just, it's not as powerful. Whereas it completely wrecks, like, Astra Militarum.
Tempest.
Yeah, it'd wreck Militarum Tempestus. It would wreck Tau. It would wreck Eldar. Like, against anything that's not either very, you know, doesn't have very good armor saves, or doesn't have much assault. Like, this will win the game, basically. Now, there is a downside to it. You do disordered. Whenever you make this charge, it counts as disordered, so you don't get your Furious Charge, and assuming you have it, and you don't get your extra attack on the charge. So, there's that, but that's a pretty minor downside to being able to poof charge and then melee. Now your big expensive shooting unit can't do anything. Yeah. So, yeah. And the fact that this is such a large formation really will allow for some pretty big shenanigans.
Oh yeah.
Yeah. I think Raptors prior to this and Warp Talons have been considered a bit weak.
Well, this, Warp Talons are 160 for...
But you don't have to bring a Warp Talon. You can bring Raptors if you choose to.
That's true. I'm just...
Yeah.
Like, this is a expensive. To get them on the table.
Yeah. So, I mean, yeah, they're overpriced and expensive, but this is a crazy formation. And admittedly, when you start paying for upgrades, it may not feel as bad, but on paper, this seems insane. To be able to deep strike 5 squads and charge.
I would like to note there's something very similar to this in the Khorne Demonkin, but
you don't get the charge.
Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. There's a reason you don't charge when you deep strike. It's powerful.
Yeah.
Like, that's an insane ability. Like, that really is. So, especially with warp talons, you have jetpacks, so you can reroll your charge distance, because you're not moving.
Well, they all have jetpacks.
Well, my point is, like,
yeah,
you, with jetpacks, you can reroll your charge distance if you don't use it to move 12 inches, which you deep strike, you're not moving. So they're going to get a reroll charge distance, too. And they get Hammer of Wrath because they're using their jetpack to charge.
Ooh.
So you're going to have each of these getting Hammer of Wrath attacks, rerolling charge distances, and deep striking all in the same turn. That's nuts. It's absolutely nuts. And there's, they have one more rule, too. But it, this one isn't as big a deal. It's a big deal, but not on the same level. So, you know, basically this rule says, oh, you have a rule book. Screw your rule book. I'm doing what I want. That's kind of what this does. The other special rule is enemy units that are charged by two or more units from the Raptor Talon subtract two from their leadership until the end of turn. So, basically it's assuming you're charging into a non-melee squad, they're already going to be losing combat and then they subtract another two. So,
could pair well with the Helldrake formation. Maybe get some.
Well, assuming they get away. I mean, you do have initiative four, so depending on what it is, you have a pretty good chance to catch them and just kill them outright if they try to run. So, yeah, especially if it's Tau, because their initiatives suck.
Excited to see how it actually works on the table,
though. Yeah, exactly. And bear in mind, we're saying this on paper without seeing performance, but on paper, this Raptor Talon formation seems absolutely insane.
Agree.
It's crazy powerful, at least on paper. Maybe after, you know, factoring in Raptors and their overall strength and paying for upgrades, it won't be quite as bad, but...
Getting those Melt-A-Bombs and...
I mean, the thing is, you're going to have a minimum three-man... And yeah, you can have Melt-A-Bombs and pay for a Power Fist, and you can basically blow up a vehicle the turn you arrive. So... Yeah, getting three squads that can do this as a minimum is, and then you can even have five. That really is insane. We see how it works, but it definitely has the potential to be very game breaking. All right, so we'll move on. The next few formations aren't quite as big a deal.
I like this one.
This one's cool, but it's, if you're going to field a lot of Terminators, you're going to bring this formation. That's kind of how a lot of these, I think, fall in.
Yeah.
But this one does have a very nice discount feature as well with it. So the formation is a Chaos Lord or Sorcerer and 3 to 5 units of Terminators. And I think it's minimum 3-man, right?
3-man.
So basically, yeah, minimum 3 squads of 95 points without upgrades. The restriction is the Lord or Sorcerer must be in Terminator armor. But you don't have to pay for it. They just get it. So it's like saving 40 points, and they just get Terminator armor.
Yeah.
That's not bad.
I was actually trying to check how much it was, but Terminator is not cheap in general.
Yeah. It's pretty good, actually. Being able to basically get something for free is always good, especially when you're talking about a codex that generally has overpriced models.
You have to buy everything.
Yeah. So saves you 40 points. So that's pretty good. 3 to 5, and your Chaos Lord can also be in this one. It can be Abaddon or Typhus instead of a Chaos Lord or Sorcerer, but just those two. Probably because they come in Terminator armor.
I was going to say, I'd probably almost recommend the standard Chaos Lord.
Yeah, because you get it for... Yeah, I agree. It's just, you have the option, but yes, I would agree. The standard Chaos Lord is probably the better choice because you're saving points by doing that, essentially. Special rules, targeted for annihilation. So prior to the start, or at the start of the game, before deployment, you choose an enemy, one unit in the enemy army. You gain hatred against that unit, and when you deep strike in, you instantly get a free shooting attack that is not part of your shooting phase at the target. So that means they basically land, instantly get a shoot, and then proceed to the shooting phase and shoot again.
Yeah.
Pretty good. You know, like, but you think, oh, it's just one unit. No big deal. Second special rule is target updated. If the unit nominated is destroyed, you can choose another enemy unit. Ad nauseum. So, basically, you just keep selecting unit, and you keep getting the special rule of Patriot, plus, you know, the first Terminator squad arrives, kills their target, nominate new one. Squad arrives, kills their target, and so on and so on. So you can essentially continue to benefit from that extra shooting attack, assuming they don't all arrive at once. Now, it's possible they all arrive at once, but generally, between three, at least one of them isn't going to come in.
Or turn one, you get real lucky.
Well, can't come in turn one.
No, I mean, like, one of your other units eliminates it.
Well, but it doesn't really help you, because...
it's annihilated, you just pick a new one.
Yeah, but my point is, you don't... only units in this formation get to do that, though. Yeah, units in the formation have Patriot.
What I'm
saying is that it doesn't really help the Terminators in question. Like, it's not like they benefited from the rule. It's just, if you happen to kill it, then yes, you can choose a new target.
Yeah.
Basically, if you're going to bring Terminators, you may as well bring this formation again. Again, it's also, if you want to bring a Lord in Terminator armor, it's a good way to get him in it for a discount.
Yeah.
Assuming you're going to bring Terminators. But, yeah. It's overall pretty solid, I think. The special rules are pretty cool. It definitely, you know, it's a neat formation. It's not... I'd say it's probably around Maelstrom of Gore in terms of interest and use, but not hitting that, you know, Raptor Talon plateau.
I'd say this would approach that if Chaos had drop pods.
Well, I mean... It doesn't really matter. Terminators deep strike anyways. And yeah, you don't put Terminators in drop pods.
You scatter, like, outside of your...
Yeah, but Terminators don't come in drop pods, do they? No, they don't. Like, I'm pretty sure they're very bulky, right? So
they won't fit. Shit.
Although, you could probably fit them in, like, Deathwatch, since they count as three, I think. And so, like, you could possibly have three fit in a drop pod. But normal Space Marines, I think, take five as a minimum squad size for terms. So, but yeah, that's Terminator Annihilation Force. It's pretty good. If you're going to bring Terminators, this is a good choice. So then we have Favorite of Chaos. I think both of us are kind of... I would say that this is probably the worst formation.
Ooh.
Debatable with the Obliterators.
Are we not counting the formation that is 1-3 spawn?
Well, no, I'm talking about the new formations. I mean, that's just a squad. That's not a formation.
Hey, counts towards the detachment.
That's not a formation. I would say it's debatably the worst. And I would say it's the worst formation here, because at least the Obliterators I can see saying, okay, I want to bring, you know, Obliterators, and I'm thinking of bringing roughly 8 worth of firepower, but I'll take my 100-point discount and spend that towards something else. At least I can see a purpose for that.
I hesitate to call this the worst just because I'm biased. I like Chaos. But there are other formations in this book that do what this is supposed to do better.
Yeah, that's the issue. You not just one, either. There's two formations that do, and arguably the Cultists formation even, can do what this one does better. And this is not cheap, because Possessed are not cheap. And neither is the Demon Prince.
Yeah.
So, the formation is Favorite of Chaos. It is a Demon Prince and 3-5 Possessed units. So
15 Possessed minimum.
Yeah, and Possessed are how much a piece? Like, for a squad?
Oh, God. They're
not cheap.
No. Sorry.
And Special Rule isn't quite enough to make this work.
Yeah, 130 for a squad. No upgrades.
130 without upgrades. So you're looking at a minimum 390 plus a Demon Prince is like 100 something.
The Demon Prince is also crazy pricey. Demon Prince 145 plus options.
So 390 plus 145. That's 435 plus 100. So 535.
And you're gonna want to put options in the Demon Prince.
So you're talking already more expensive than the Raptor Talon, or even the Gore, Gore, Maelstrom of Gore, is that what they're called?
Yeah,
Maelstrom of Gore. So it's more expensive than those already, and the special rules aren't enough to... It's not even like on the same level, the special rules. So the special rule is, as long as the possessed are within 12 inches of the Demon Prince, they get all of their mutations, which is essentially they get Shred, they get AP3, and what's the last one?
Plus one
attack
and initiative, or something like that.
Yeah, it's plus one attack and something, but this is a melee-based squad, and they're not given anything to help them arrive in melee.
Yeah, attack and initiative.
If there is a defensive mutation for them, like plus one armor save, or reroll failed saves, or, you know, 3-up invul, or something. Yeah. Some sort of, you know, beneficial effect for them that's a defensive mutation.
Like the spawn armor.
Yeah, like the spawn armor or something, but they don't have that. They're just still foot slogging, and yeah, they're a melee required squad, expensive, and although not to shake your head at it, I mean, an extra attack per model at AP3 and Shred is powerful, and it absolutely is, but short of fighting against like orcs or something, like unless you're fighting against an assault squad, why would you bring that? And you have to even ask yourself against orcs, why would I bring this over Maelstrom of Gore? Like, Maelstrom of Gore is cheaper, you get more units, and you got that extra, you know, I can make all my guys attack again without you getting to fight back. Yep. Like,
you're just going to take it.
I'm sure you can find a use for Favorite of Chaos. Again, probably against orcs or like or a melee-based Tyranid army or something. Something that's going to rush you with weak units.
I mean, if you have the models, like, I'd love to see this on the table.
Yeah, it's just, I mean, obviously, stuff is always cool to at least try out, but yeah. It's not something that's going to make you go, I want to field this. I'm going to go buy two more Possessed or something. Like, it's, if you have the models, you might give it a try and then be like, eh. But
if you're going to go out and purchase other things, like, I'd work on the other formations.
Yeah, the other formations, if you're choosing, you know, what your next purchase is based on, I want to field this formation, this is not the formation to look at first. This is the vanity formation that, you know, you have nothing else to do, and, like,
you have this beautifully painted demon.
Yeah, there you go. And it's a good way to, you know, get something sort of thematic on the table.
Speaking of vanity formations.
Yes, speaking of vanity formations, we have the ultimate vanity formation, Trinity of Blood. This is 3 Corn Lord of Skulls, which is 2,660 points without upgrades. 2,660 points without upgrades. That is,
this is just your, like,
for 3 guys. Yeah. I mean, this is 3 badass guys, I guess.
And it's cheaper to take 3 knights.
Yeah.
Imperial knights.
Oh, yeah. Well, these are probably Wrecking Imperial knights, but, yeah.
I'd like to see that.
I have a feeling, based on stats, these would be Wrecking Imperial knights. Oh. But it doesn't change the fact that that is an absurd amount of points. Like, just one of them is an absurd amount of points, and you're bringing 3. Yeah. So, why would you do this other than for the sheer lulls of it, basically?
For the glory of Korn.
Yeah. So, special rules. They all get Rampage. That's not a bad one to get. That's the Rampage is the one that, if you're outnumbered, and you're gonna be, they get an extra, I think, D3 attacks? Where's the D6? I don't know.
We'd have to look.
One or the other. I don't think that's not, Rampage isn't the one on a charge, right? Where you get plus one attack? I don't think it is. I think Rampage is the outnumbered one.
Yeah.
And you get an extra amount of attacks as long as you're outnumbered, which there's no way you're not going to be, unless you're fighting a knight or something. But at the start, the other one is apoplectic?
I think so.
Whatever. Storm. At the start of the formation's movement. It is not apocalyptic. I know what that word is. This is, I don't even, apoplectic. Plectic.
What'd you call it?
Apoplectic. There we go. Apoplectic. Storm. At the start of the formation's movement, any enemy unit locked in combat with any models from this formation are engulfed in a scorching storm of rage-fueled energy. They take Strength 6, AP 4 hits that ignores cover, and has Soul Blaze. All wounds are randomly allocated. So
drive that into that horde of orcs and
yeah, basically, like it just by its sheer existence, it would kill everything. Like essentially, what that means is they can't kill you with numbers with this. Like they have to have their own big guy on the table, or shoot this from a long ways away to blow it up.
Well, even then, some of the guns seem to be pretty nice.
Yeah, yeah. But it is locked in combat, so yeah. It's not like just by, you know, being next to it, you gotta actually be in combat with it, so. I guess if you need more kill on your Lord of Skulls, this is a way to get it. Next one, Crashing Volleys. Weapons used by a model of Trinity of Blood have Twin Link special rule if they're used to attack a target that's already been attacked by another model from the formation in the shooting phase. So, basically, if one of these guys shoots at something, then another, you know, the other one or two can shoot at the same target and get a reroll failed hits.
Why wouldn't you? Shoot it till it's gone.
Yeah. Then you can't charge it, though. So, in fairness, it's super heavy, so it can shoot its weapons at different targets and then choose one to charge. So, yeah. I don't even know what to say about this formation. If you have three of these and you're playing basically an apocalypse game, like, that's about the only time you're going to get these guys on the field. It's like I said, minimal cost of 2660. So, that's without upgrades, which means you're never really going to be able to field them in any... Like, a 3,000-point game would be the smallest you could field them in.
I would love to see it, though.
And like, that's pretty much Apocalypse size at that point. I mean, obviously Apocalypse is larger, but... I mean, when you're getting to that size, it's just like, why aren't you playing an Apocalypse game at this stage? Like, that's... Yeah, by all means, someone who has this, by all means, build this, and I would love to see it. But, it's absolutely insane.
Yeah.
Even think about feeling that. So before we go to the detachment, we're just gonna very briefly cover the new psychic disciplines. I'm not gonna go into everything because there's four of them, but
a lot of new psychic powers.
Lots of psychic powers. So the issue is all psychers with Chaos Space Marine faction can choose from any of these disciplines. So basically, you're a sorcerer, you can bring it.
Should make a note about the mark, though.
Oh, yeah. So the marks, the usual mark rules apply. If you have mark of, you know, Nurgle, you have to generate at least one power from mark of Nurgle. Yeah. So, or, you know, whatever your mark is for your sorcerer. But then you can choose to generate from these. So we're starting with Sinestrum. Their primaries. The Sinestrum, in our opinion, is probably the safe pick. Like, there's only going to be one that's bad, and only if your opponent has no psychers. Everything else is good. Yeah, everything else is good. And even against them, like, there's enough good here that you might pick it against them. Mostly because the Primaris is so good. Primaris, 18-inch range, Strength 5, AP 3, Assault 1, Blast, Warp Charge 1. Then you have Warp Fate. It's a blessing that's essentially fortune for Eldar. It's lets you reroll up. The Psyker and his unit reroll all failed saving throws, warp charge 2 on that. Impurigeist, warp charge 1. It is a 20-inch strength 6, AP 4, assault 1, pinning beam. Beams are a bit crazy. You basically just like take a line and everything along that line gets hit. So beams are interesting, and it has pinning, so strength 6, AP 4 is nothing to sneeze at either. So it's an interesting ability. Warp charge 1 on that. Armor of Hatred, warp charge 1. Blesses the Psyker. When all you friendly units within 12 inches of the Psyker have Fearless and Adamantium Will. And they get a 4-up invuln save against Witchfire powers. Diabolic Strength is the next one. The Psyker gets plus 2 Strength, Initiative, Toughness, and Attacks. So if you want your Psyker to become the biggest melee badass ever, there you go.
Yeah.
That's also Warp Charge 1. Then we have what is incredibly powerful if your opponent has a lot of Psykers, called Warp Lure. Basically, it's a Warp Charge 1, strength 24-inch Malediction. You roll 2 dice, add your psychic level to it, mastery level to it, and your opponent rolls one dice and adds their mastery level to it. If you equal or beat them, your opponent takes a wound with no saves allowed. And if you beat them by at least three, your opponent not only takes a wound, but they lose a psychic power. That's pretty devastating. Again, you're going to have to roll for that one. It's not primaries, but if your opponent is very psyker heavy, then thinking Eldar or Grey Knights or something like that, then this is crazy powerful.
Yeah.
Next, we have Death Hex, Malediction, 24-inch range. This target gets minus 2 penalty to invuln saves. So they cannot be reduced to past 6, so at 6 they stop. So if you put it on Harlequins, they just go from 5 to 6. But
that Harlequins aren't what you'd be.
No, no. You're targeting Storm Shields, or if you're fighting other Chaos Demons, things like that, that have good invuln saves.
Lich Guard from the
Lich Guard, yeah. So that's your target with that. But that one is Warp Charge 2. So then we come to Heretic. So you can kind of guess by the name, this one is going to be all vehicle themed. You're basically going to bring this if your opponent has a lot of vehicles or if you have a lot of vehicles. Otherwise, you're probably going to leave this one alone because they're, like, when we're talking a lot of vehicles, we're talking like that's the majority of their forces. They have vehicles everywhere.
You're running like
not like your opponent. Yeah, not like your opponent has like two or three vehicles, or that you have like two or three vehicles. This is something like you're bringing a lot of Hellbrutes and Forge Fiends, or your opponent is like tanks everywhere.
Yeah.
Like, that is when you take Heretic. Otherwise, you're not touching it.
You're running the Fist of God formation here.
Yeah. So, Corrupt Machine, basically, you and your opponent roll a dice. It's 18-inch Malediction. Let's see. If the power is successful, randomly select a weapon. You cannot select one-use weapons or one-shot only that have already been fired. If your opponent beats you on the roll, nothing happens. If you tie the roll, then the weapon fires snapshots. If you win the roll, you get to use that weapon on your opponent at the vehicle's ballistic skill. If the vehicle's snapshotting, like, you know, shaken or is jinked, then it is a snapshot. It does specify that. But that's kind of cool. You can, like, your opponent has this tank and it has an infantry line in front of it. You take control of the tank and you blow up the infantry line in front. That's a pretty fun power. Warp Charge 1.
I could be wrong. I don't think you can fire barrage weapons with snapshots.
No, no, that's only if it's shaken.
No, I mean, normally, like, so at, you tie them, the worst thing that happens is you prevent them from firing that blast
correct.
Template.
Correct. They can't, yeah. So they won't be able to fire blast anymore. So then we have number one here, Boon of the Iron Beast, Warp Charge 1. Basically, it's a 24-inch blessing that can target, only targets vehicles, and can target the vehicle that, if the Warpsmith is inside a transport, it can target his own transport. Basically, the vehicle gets to ignore crew shaken, and the vehicle gets Power of the Machine Spirit. If the vehicle already has that, then it gets plus one ballistic skill when using Power of the Machine Spirit. It's okay. Warp Charge 1. This is when you get into some pretty crazy stuff for vehicles. Focused Witchfire, 18-inch on a vehicle. The target suffers D3 Strength 1 AP dash hits of Haywire. So
the Haywire is killer.
Yeah. So basically, that's Warp Charge 1. Then you have Dark Invigoration, Warp Charge 1. Blessing, 24-inch range. Let's see. It can recover a hull point, it can repair a destroyed weapon or a mobilized result, and the vehicle also gains It Will Not Die. So, pretty good. That one's Warp Charge 1. This one is Warp Charge 2, Flesh Metal Hide. Blessing, it can target vehicles or infantry here. If it targets a vehicle, it adds one armor to all armor facings. If it targets an infantry or, you know, non-vehicle, the models get plus one toughness. It's decent.
Yeah.
Warp Charge 2. And again, if he's in a transport, he can put it on his own vehicle. Electromortis. This is a 18-inch Strength 1 AP-Beam Assault 1 Haywire. So pretty much a guaranteed Haywire hit if you want it. Or if your opponent has a lot of tanks in a line, there you go. Then we have another one that's pretty crazy. Flare Storm, Warp Charge 2, Focused Witchfire against vehicles. Targets an enemy with an 18 inches. The vehicle automatically instantly loses D3 hull points. For each whole point lost, the Psyker inflicts D6, Strength 4, AP 6 hits on a unit within 12 inches. So if it loses 3, you could potentially be doing 18 Strength 4, Strength 6, AP 4 hits. No, Strength 4, AP 6 hits. Yeah. Again, this is really good if your opponent has, like, is Astra Militarum and they have a gun line in front of their tanks, then you do that to the tank, and then the tank kills all the infantry in front of it, so...
I think Space Marines has something very similar. It's like Electric Storm or Electric
Cube. Yeah. So that's Heretech. We have Ectomancy, which is probably the one that you go to if you want to do some, like, odd little shenanigans, basically. Primaris, it's overall good, but it's probably not as good as Sinestrum overall. Warp Shock, Primaris, 18-inch, Strength 5, AP 4, Assault 6. So it's probably one of the better Primarises, though. Warp Charge 1 on that, so it's pretty easy to manifest. In Empiric Shield, the Psyker gets a 3-up invul, Warp Charge 1. Demon Shriek, Warp Charge 1, 9-inch, Strength 1, AP Dash, Assault 1, Haywire. It is a Nova, so... anything within 9 inches of it takes a Haywire hit, essentially. Coruscating Blaze, Warp Charge 2. You choose a, let's see, which firepower? Strength 5, AP 4, Assault D6. So, Lethal Discharge is a special rule. After the attack is resolved against the target, roll a dice for every other enemy unit within 6 inches. On a 4, that basically you repeat the process, except... that one cannot spawn more. So just the initial
this
one.
Is the one I'm thinking of.
Yeah, just the initial one can cause damage, and basically on a 50-50 shot to have it spread to affect other models within 6 inches. So it's not a big thing, but if your opponent's clustered, it's not bad. Infernal Claws, sort of the poor man's version of Diabolic Strength, I guess. Warp Charge 1. Infernal Claw is blessing that targets the Psyker. The Psyker adds 1 to both strength and attacks. In addition, every time the Psyker hits an enemy, the unit also suffers an additional strength 5, 2 additional strength 5 AP dash hits. So, yeah. Basically, you can cause a lot of hits.
But you're getting your armor and your...
Yeah. Ghost Storm, it basically 18... unit within 80, blessing targeting unit within 18 inches. You can essentially pick up that unit and move it 18 inches. It cannot charge, though. It ignores all height and terrain and other enemy units. You basically just move it as the crow flies wherever you want.
Can't end on top of them.
Yeah. Well, if you end in any sort of difficult terrain, the models have to take dangerous terrain tests.
Yeah.
But, yeah. They cannot charge, but they can shoot.
But it treats...
Yeah, so if you've moved a heavy weapon squad, they do count as moving. Unless they have Relentless, obviously.
Yeah.
And then you kind of have the major, at least, shenanigan ability here. Soul Switch. Blessing targets a non-vehicle unit within 24 inches. You basically swap the position of that unit and the Psyker and his unit. Now, it's a friendly model, so you can't do this to an enemy. But so basically, if you say infiltrate a squad... put the sorcerer with like a squad of Khorne Berserkers, swap with the infiltrate. Now you can't move, but mostly because moving phase is over. However, you can charge. So you could potentially treat it like a 24-inch movement and then charge off of that. So there's some interesting shenanigans to be pulled there, to be sure.
Definitely.
That one's warp charge too. Then we have Geomortis, which, two things are here. One, probably the most singular fun ability out of any psychic discipline I've ever seen. This is a really cool, fun ability. And then, probably the most broken, like when I say broken, awfully broken psychic abilities I have ever seen. If you're taking Geomortis, you're essentially saying, I am rolling for this one ability because I wish to be that guy.
And you probably brought the Obliterator formation.
Yeah. Because this is broken as fuck. That's all I can say about it. But So we have Primaris Power, Rock Maw, Warp Charge 2. Targets an enemy within 18 inches of the Psyker that's not locked in combat. They all take dangerous terrain tests. Eh. No effect on flying. Lay Leech, Warp Charge 1. So keep in mind that the Primaris is Warp Charge 2 based on the description. When we come to then what I'm talking about. Lay Leech, Warp Charge 1. Blessing targets a friendly non-vehicle unit within 18 inches. Basically, it's a heal. You restore D3 wounds, essentially. It doesn't say anything about resurrecting or anything, so it's specifically it says character, I think. So, yeah. Rupture, Warp Charge 1. This is kind of cool. You, like, point to a spot within 24 inches, and then all units within 24, or within 6 inches of that point take a single Strength 5 AP4 hit. However, that also everything within 6 inches of that point becomes dangerous terrain. So just normal moving makes you take dangerous terrain tests. So
it's like a little tar pit.
Yeah. So it's kind of a cool ability. It's very anti-assault based, but it's fun. And that's kind of the theme of Geomortis. It generally tries to be anti-assault army until you get to that one stupid ability. So then you also have next one, Torture of Worlds, Warp Charge 1. All enemy units within 18 inches suffer a malediction. They cannot run, turbo boost, or flat out. It has no effect on flyers again. So, basically, again, really good against assault armies because you can't run anymore. And then we have...
Your favorite.
Then we have the issue, in my honest opinion here. This thing could be Warp Charge 3, and it would still be really powerful. However, this is Warp Charge 1, which makes no goddamn sense. Warp Charge 1, this is called Earthly Anathema. It's a blessing. Targets a single unit within 24 inches. So this is a long-range spell, too. Lots of big blessings. That's a long-range blessing. The unit gets moved through cover. Okay. The unit now also ignores cover. That's usually a bad special rule. That's usually a really powerful special rule. The unit can now attack without needing line of sight to the enemy target. Warp Charge 1 doesn't need line of sight and ignores their cover. It feels like there's one unit here that would really been... Oh, right. The Obliterators. Oh, they can fire twice. Cool. Yeah.
Better have a good invuln save.
Yeah, pretty much. Because you're not going to have an armor save, and you're not going to have a cover save. You are just... This is literally a Warp Charge 1 Finger of God ability that says, I'm pointing to that unit. It's going to die. For Warp Charge 1. I have no idea how this made it into... Chaos needs help, but they don't need a Finger of God spell.
This is, of course, assuming you roll it. There's still some...
Yeah, but... Okay, let's say you take Typhus. You roll 1 on your stupid Nurgle thing, and then you spend your other 3 rolling on Geomortis. Like, if you have someone at the high Psyker level, you're going to roll on Geomortis because you're going to have a lot of chances to get it. Because that is absolutely... It's literally a Finger of God, I'm killing that unit for one Warp Charge 1. I don't even understand what went through Games Workshop's head to make this spell, much less at Warp Charge 1. This would be something you would want even if it was Warp Charge 3. You would be willing to throw that many dice at it so that you could just say, I'm killing that unit. This is the definition of a Warp Charge 3 spell. I'm going to kill that unit.
As we've talked, like, this might get FAQ'd very soon.
It is incredibly broken to give ignores cover to any unit. It's not like, you know, the Tau or something that have, like, that homing missile. At least that's only AP, like, 5. So it's not going to kill your armor. It's not going to ignore your armor. You can give this to a unit that will ignore someone's armor and shoot at them, even if they've positioned properly, and possibly from across the map, depending on the weapon length. Like, basically, you cannot defend against this spell. And at Warp Charge 1, you don't have any recourse. Like, they're going to get it off.
Jeez, yeah.
Like, if I were to have one issue with the Codex, this is definitely it.
You want to go Warp Talon?
You mean the Raptor Talon?
Yeah.
I would choose to fight with Raptor Talon more than I would to deal with this spell.
Okay.
Because this is a Warp Charge 1, I'm killing this unit. Raptor Talon's broken in its own right on paper. Again, we specify on paper. Whenever in practice it could differ, but on paper it seems broken. This, there's no on paper to this. This just is broken. Like, Warp Charge, the primary's power is Warp Charge 2 makes your opponent take dangerous terrain tests. This, Warp Charge 1, ignore cover and can shoot anywhere.
I think
ignoring line of sight.
Probably to dissuade you from rolling on this with your, like, Seger level 1. That you get something else and now you're stuck with the Primus.
I don't... It doesn't matter. This...
Yeah, no, that...
It's way too... Yeah, exactly. That's the issue. It's like, even with a shitty Primus, you still have a 1 in 6 chance to get a Finger of God spell. Which... And it's not like... There are some other ones on here that are okay. They just aren't as good as, like, you know, Sinestrum or something.
They're
or
okay, and some are actually pretty fun.
And then, yes, we're coming to the fun one here in a sec, but it bears ranting about this spell because you have a Warp Charge 1 Finger of God spell, which is awful. That's absolutely awful. You can't do that. That's...
You didn't play Chaos when they sucked.
No, but it doesn't... I don't...
I'm thrilled that we have it.
We will probably house rule this to be a minimum Warp Charge 2, just because that's pretty crazy. But... Yeah, that spell is broken. And you can't even argue that that spell's not broken. Warp Charge 1 ignores cover and ignore line of sight. Like... it's broken. But before it's even seen play, it's broken. Just on text. Don't even have to debate that one. Even Daniel's like, yeah.
Oh yeah, I can hide my obliterators way back here.
Shove them in a corner, like in this corner of this building where they have no line of sight with a sorcerer. It's like, ha ha ha, get them! Yeah.
Every turn.
Fuck, that's insane. So there you go. Number 5 here, Profane Ruination, Warp Charge 1. This is another cool spell. This is a cool spell.
Yeah.
Witchfire Power targets a building or a ruin. So you don't really get a lot of these. So these are pretty cool. If you target a building, roll a dice. On a 1 to 3, the building suffers a glancing hit. On a 4 to 6, it's a penetrating hit. If you target a ruin, roll a dice for each unit that is even partially in the ruins. On a 4 or more, the target suffers D6 AP dash hits, randomly allocated. It's not amazing, but it's Warp Charge 1, and it's a fun spell. There's some, you know, especially with the amount of ruins we play with, you would definitely get use out of that.
Yeah. So, I think it even justifies it, like, its rubble falling on the units.
Yeah, that's what it says. It says the, you know, building falls apart and falls onto the units.
It's fun, it's fluffy.
Yeah.
It's not...
It's a good example of what a spell should be. The fun, you know, useful spell. And it just happens to be next to the other one. And then we have, by far, I think the coolest spell I have ever seen in anything. And this is a really fun spell. I don't think it will ever... It's not necessarily the most useful, but it is very fun. This thing is Warp Charge 3. It's called Worldwrithe. You target a terrain feature, so a piece of terrain within 24 inches of the Psyker. The Psyker then gets to pick that terrain up and move it up to 24 inches from its starting position. And it has to stay 1 inch away from enemy models, or any model, and other terrain pieces. So you can't, like, stack it on top of, like... it's like this bridge stacks on top of a ruin or something. Like, that'd be pretty cool, but you can't do that.
I'm going to put this forest in a building.
Yeah, this forest is in the building now. So, how does that interact with your opponent? Well, if the opponent has, or if any unit, not just your opponent, any units that are completely on the piece of terrain in question move with the terrain. You can actually, like, put your obliterators or whatever, I don't know, army you want. Let's just say you put a bunch of Khorne berserkers, sit them in a ruin. Pick up that ruin, set it next to your opponent, your berserkers can now charge. That is awesome! Yeah, right? That's freaking awesome! You can literally use this to move your berserkers 24 inches to get an assault in.
I was complaining we didn't have a drop pod before.
It's just, a building! You just gotta drop a building on him. That's the secret here. Drop a freaking building next to him. You'll be good. That's all the drop pod you need. That's really cool, right? Yeah. And you can also use that, you know, adversarially. If your opponent is camping on a building, you can pick up the building and move it next to your berserkers.
Or if it has an objective in it.
Yeah, move the objective, because everything moves with it. Pretty nuts. And if models that are not... If a unit's not completely in on a terrain structure, the units do not go with the terrain. They actually fall off, basically, and they take a number of dangerous terrain equal to the models that would have fallen off the terrain.
But I think it says it's like if your rhino explodes, it's like that's how you deter it. It's like 6 inches away from...
No, it's not explodes. It's basically, yeah, you have to move them 6 inches away from... Basically, the entire unit moves 6 inches away from the terrain.
Yeah.
From it's the
emergency...
The yeah. No, called? Not emergency disembark, because it doesn't treat it as an explode. It just says as disembarking. But every edge is a disembarkation point. So basically, you just move... Your opponent gets to move 6 inches away from the terrain and then takes a number of dangerous terrain checks equal to the amount of models that fell off the terrain, basically.
If you were using this against me and I had only like one model off it, I'd ask if you could hop on for the ride.
Yeah. In any case, this is a phenomenal spell. This is awesome. It really is awesome. And now practicality... I don't know. I mean, like we said, there's uses. If you roll for this spell, you're going to deploy all your berserkers in this building, and you're going to move the building next to your opponent. Turn one, and you get a charge.
The other thing I discussed with you is perhaps you move something to, like, clear a deep strike zone.
Yeah, true. You could also, like, you know, if there's a deep strike you want, but that building's in the way, you move the building out of the way, and you hopefully have a deep strike spot next turn. So, yeah, there's a lot of fun applications for this in... I wish there was more spells like these, this one and the previous one, but not Finger of God spells like Earthly Anathema. And I find it really sad that two of, specifically this World Ride spell, is in the same tree as Anathema up here. Cause,
well, like World Ride, Rupture, what's that other one? Profane.
Yeah.
Like those are all pretty fun.
Yeah, there's a lot of fun spells in this tree. It's just really unfortunate that Anathema is in here because it ruins the whole tree, in my opinion, in terms of... Instead of being like, oh, my opponent's Aurelion Geomortis, that could be a fun thing to play against. Instead you're thinking, ah, shit, my opponent's Aurelion Geomortis, he's going for that stupid Anathema and he's going to cheese the shit out of me. Like, that is literally the difference in thinking. It's that close to being an awesome, fun spell, but it's not. Or tree, but it's literally ruined because of Anathema.
It almost would have made more sense to me, at least, to see that appear in, like, the Hextech one.
Yeah, I agree. So, alright, so now we're to the detachments here. The detachment is called Black Crusade Detachment. Restrictions, you have to have one core choice, one auxiliary choice, and it can have up to 5 command choices and any number of core, of additional core or auxiliary. Okay, so whenever we go over what these are, we'll tell you what they are, or what the, you know, what they qualify as.
That's pretty standard for any
detachment. Yeah, well now, it's very similar to a lot of the newer Codex detachment rules. So you have command benefits, Lord of Chaos. The detachment is your primary guy, you can reroll your Warlord trait from Chaos Space Marines.
Yeah.
Normal stuff. Death to the False Emperor. All units in the detachment get Hatred Imperium. And all, if they can have it, get Veterans of the Long War for free. So plus one leadership across the board, and hatred if you're fighting Imperials. So yeah. It's not a bad special roll, actually.
No.
For a detachment-wide special roll, it's pretty good. Again, it keeps in line with the theme of the book, which is sort of discounts with the veterans of the Long War for free.
Yeah, that's going to be nice. All your Marines get plus one leadership.
So, final one, Path to Glory. At the start of each friendly turn, choose a model in this detachment with Champions of Chaos, special rule. And roll on the Chaos Boon Table. So it's the start of each of your turns, you get to do this, and roll on this Chaos Boon Table. If the model also has the Favored Scions rule, which is from Chaos Warband, you get to roll twice and pick one or both of the results. So, basically, this is where we were talking about earlier, Chaos Warband being more relevant. If you're putting it in the detachment at the start of the game and at the start of every turn, you're basically going to get Chaos Boons.
Yeah.
So.
Which is nice, because otherwise you need to fight those challenges.
Yeah, exactly. So it's a way to, you know, make your guys stronger before you actually have to get in there.
Yeah. Make them more likely to win some of them.
Yeah. And then generate more. So, we have the command choice, which is Lords of the Black Crusade. It can be a Lord, Sorcerer, or Demon Prince. And then, as per usual, you can have, like, Typhus or Karn or something like that be used. And that's the mandatory command choice there. That's the optional command choice. So you can have up to five of those in any amount. So you can have five Demon Princes if you wanted to. Just because. Then we have, core choice. This one you are required one of. The choices here are the Chaos Warband, the Maelstrom of Gore, and the Lost and the Damned. So you have the Cultists, the Berserker Squad, or the, the big Warband. And you got to have at least one of them. You can have any amount, though, that you want.
You could take all three if you wanted.
Yeah, or you could take multiple of, one, but doesn't really matter. Yeah. Those are your three choices for your core, and you got to have at least one of those three. So, all three of those have merits. The Chaos Warband synergizes really well with Path to Glory. With Path to Glory. So, pretty much, Path to Glory makes Chaos Warband good. Without it, Chaos Warband's kind of just a slightly modified
Cad.
Yeah. And, it's okay. But, this is what makes it good, is the detachment. And then, obviously, Maelstrom and Gore and Lost in the Damned.
You still get, the Champion of Chaos boon, but you won't get the extra bonus for
Favorite Scion. Yeah, exactly. So you can still roll, but you only get one dice, and you have to take the result, whereas if you have Chaos Warband, you can roll twice, and you can choose both or one. So it makes it a lot less likely to become spawn or something. Or be just killed or something. Then we have auxiliary choices. Auxiliary choices are pretty much everything else. You have the Hellforged War Pack. You can take Veteran of Legions, which is basically a unit of Khorne Berserkers, Plague Marines, or Thousand Sons, or Noise Marines. So
Special Marines.
Yeah. Any of the flavors of Marines from their different Chaos Deities count here, and you can take 1 to 4 units, and that counts as a Veteran of the Legion. So you could take 4 units of Plague Marines, and that counts as a single auxiliary slot if you want to. Or whatever else it is you want to bring. Also auxiliary are the Helldrake Terror Pack, the Cult of Destruction, which was the Obliterator of Warpsmith Squad, Fist of the God, which is the Predator, Vindicator, Land Raider thing, Raptor Talon, the Terminator Annihilation Force, which is the terms, Favorite of Chaos, Demon Prince, and Possessed, Trinity of Blood. So, I find this hilarious. You're trying to force this into this. So yeah, you can put a 2,660 point as one of your auxiliaries. Why not?
And then the last one, my favorite.
And then the last one, you can have a Squad of Spawn as the final auxiliary choice.
1 to 3
units. So you can have 3 units of spawn if you really want to. But, guys, the only other thing in here really is just Renegade Knight. Basically, all it really is a formation that lets you take three of them. There's no real benefits. Well, the benefit is if the detachment has three renegade knights, it forms a fallen household, and if all models have preferred and all models have preferred enemy imperial knight.
But the inverse then is true. Imperial knights get hatred of you.
Yeah. However, such is the enmity, yes. So then, if you take this formation, if the opponent even has one Imperial Knight, then they get hatred you as well. So.
But yeah. It finally got its own like little data.
Yeah, there's not a lot to talk about here. If you have Imperial Knights, you're probably familiar with what they have, and if you're not, well, this isn't an Imperial Knight review. This has probably been a long enough review.
Sorry.
Yeah, there's a lot to talk about with all the different formations and the ways that they abuse all their special rules and all the four freaking new Psyker spell trees, essentially. So there's a lot to talk about, and we do apologize for this being a longer video. Hopefully you guys have utilized the annotations to find, you know, the different sections you're looking for. They'll be broken down into the spells, the formations, and the detachment talk. And hopefully you guys have found that helpful. Or if you guys want to go back and, you know, listen to a specific part, check the comments, and it'll be down there for you guys to quickly, hopefully, move between them. As always, guys, thanks for watching. And if you enjoy these, please do like and or subscribe. There should hopefully be a game in the near future utilizing the Traitor's Hate / Daniel. Hopefully we'll get a game in here with that, and that'll go up in the near-ish future, maybe against the much larger Death Watch. So, if you're watching this and you're also wondering why hasn't the game that, or you know, the thing that has been alluded to, why hasn't that gone up yet? Well, today has been chock full of reading Traitor's Hate, figuring out how to make this video, making the video, and we're going to end up playing a match here, which will hopefully go up at some point soon-ish. But prior to that, there's going to be another small Death Watch versus Harlequin game, or Harlequin / Dark Eldar game, going up before this. So, anyways, guys, thank you so much for watching. Until next time, take care.